Okay, so let's move on. So that was my little interjection of sort of maybe not exactly what you thought I would present on how to use models, but I think the point is to be aware of the biases and limitations, and don't perfect prog a model out, you know, even a day, because there's just too many errors in general, especially when you get into the details. Okay, so let's talk. So we're talking about models roughly equivalent to 12, 13 kilometer grid spacing. Let's jump that physics no man's land and go down to what we call convection-allowing models. You'll see it sometime in the literature as convection permitting. We have a strong preference at SPC to call it convection allowing, just because you can say cam, and that's a lot easier than convection permitting, having to say that every time. So we're still sort of in the mesoscale. We're at the bottom end of the mesogamma scale, right, from this roughly mesoscale to microscale breakdown, where the convection parameterized models, you know, you're really resolving a lot of things in meso-beta scale there, 20 to 200 kilometers. We're going to go down to 3 to 4 kilometer grid spacing and resolve some of the meso-gamma scale features and some aspects of deep convection. So, yeah, this is certainly the case as as resolution increases, we have more computing power. We're able to run finer resolution. Obviously, we're going to get better forecasts. Well, some aspects are, that's true. I mean, you certainly resolve the terrain better, and so you can get better forecasts in the terrain if you have the right terrain in the model as boundary condition. But we saw that the physics aspects, very complicated. So, you know, what parameterizations do you need to keep? The parameterizations used at 12 kilometers may not be appropriate for that. Do you have to drop it completely like we do with convective parameterization when we jump from 12 to 4? A lot of the modelers have tried to keep in some sort of shallow convective parameterization to help with the subgrid scale cloudiness, because you can introduce, you know, warm dry biases if you don't have enough clouds, you know, shallow cumulus, and so forth. And so, you know, it's not that easy to get better forecasts just by increasing the resolution. I think we saw that with the GFS as well. In general, you really have to count and tune your physics basically to perform the best for a given resolution. And you have to obviously resolve, as you get finer and finer, you have to resolve things more appropriately. So why are we interested in CAMs? What advantage are we going to get out of this? Obviously, getting better environment forecasts is helpful. You know, the Cape shear space and boundaries and that type of thing. But obviously, just getting the environment alone isn't probably going to be enough. Because here's just a simple example, looking at significant tornado events, the red dots there, non-tornadic supercells are the blue symbols. You have effective SRH on the y-axis, MLCAPE on the x-axis. And you can see there, you know, in general, significant tornadoes, they occur above 100 meters squared per second squared of effective SRH. So, you know, most of those in the low SRH parameter space are the non-tornadic supercells. And then you have quite a range of overlap there, roughly 100 to 300 or so SRH, where you can get tornadic and non-tornadic supercells. And then it's generally just the tornadic supercells above 300 or so. But there's a large overlap, basically, is the point, that just given a certain environment, you're not guaranteed a certain hazard or mode of storm. So there's a lot more to consider than just some of these simple Cape shear type of combinations. Here's another example showing two soundings that look pretty similar. Subjectively, it'd be hard to really pick out differences. The hodograph's not shown, so you can't see the details of that. But in general, you have similar Cape values, veering winds with height, you know, similar wind speed magnitudes throughout. So it's not obvious that you would get different convective modes from that. So the sounding on the left, we had tornadic supercell, F producing F4, and then on the right you get a Boeing convective system that resulted in a lot of wind reports, where the one on the left was more of a tornadic event. So, you know, we need more information than just some of the, you know, basic environmental parameters to help us determine convective mode. And in fact, I mean, we do know that a supercell environment, large SRH, veering winds with height, that's also very favorable for MCS development. And so often you could have upscale growth of, if you have enough storms, may initially have supercell mode that transitions to MCS. So that's fairly common as well. So there's a lot of overlap. It's maybe it's just not that they're different, they form in different environments, it's just what stage of the life cycle are you in of the convective evolution. Okay, so obviously one of the main reasons for CAMS is to get convective mode information. So we all know that your severe hazard is largely dependent on your convective mode. You're going to get your strongest tornadoes, of course, in discrete supercells. You can get, obviously, tornadoes in embedded mesovortices and QLCSs, though generally a lot, you know, most of those tornadoes are F2 or EF2 or less. Your violent tornadoes are almost exclusively discrete supercells. And then, again, you can get damaging wind from basically any storm mode, from microbursts where you have, you know, deep well-mixed boundary layer, to multi-cell storms, to obviously supercells. But in terms of a wide damaging wind swath, you're going to need a forward propagating MCS to produce a large area of wind reports. So CAMS can also help give us timing of storms and then the convective mode evolution, where we're just not going to get those details from models with convective parameterization, though, you know, 12-kilometer NAM can give you a little more detail. You can almost pick out where it's expecting more discrete storms versus not. This is an older version of NAM that was coarser. So, you know, you can get sort of the mesoscale areas of precip approximately right with the models with convective parameterization. But it's not going to get all the details right, obviously, of, you know, are there discrete storms, how contiguous, and all of that. And obviously, if you try to apply a reflectivity algorithm to a coarser model, you know, you're not going to see the details of convective mode as well. There's an interesting example. I didn't put it in here, but it was earlier this month where we had a moderate risk scout for, I think, largely, you know, tornadic event across southern Alabama. And then that was in the day two forecast, actually. In the initial day one, I was working with the Outlook forecaster on that. And a lot of the CAMs, we started getting CAM guidance into that day. And we're pretty much consensus that all the CAMs were bringing MCS across southern Alabama, and it would wipe out instability, and there was no chance for recovery that far south for severe storms. So it was the evolution of the CAPE forecast is very interesting. In the parent NAM, it just, you know, couldn't resolve the MCS across that area. And so the instability basically never dropped off as minor precip, and so it got very unstable the next afternoon, where the parent NAM, the CONUS NAM, which was embedded in its parent, it had a much different evolution because it resolved the convection across that area. It chewed up all the instability across there and never had any redevelopment back behind. And so, I mean, that's obviously one of the major advantages of, if you're resolving, you know, storm mode and evolution in the CAMs that the parents, the coarser models can't, you know, you're going to get a much better forecast often in terms of instability the next day and give you a lot better idea of where severe weather might occur. Obviously, you guys are probably familiar with the ability to simulate supercells down at these scales. Obviously, 4 kilometers is very coarse to simulate supercell processes, but surprisingly, you know, it does have some representation of what occurs in supercell. You get updraft rotation, and you get something that looks pretty reasonable. There's a 4 kilometer cam. And so, again, one of the things that, how can we best utilize this information? We don't really want to be looking at 500 millibar heights and vorticity on a 3 kilometer grid. It's, you know, it's going to be very noisy for one, and forecasters are very used to looking at more of a smooth pattern. We want just the general evolution of those types of fields pattern-wise. But what we can really get information from CAMs are what we call storm attribute fields, things like updraft helicity, UH, which I'm sure you guys have heard of before. This is the equation there. It's the vertical integral of W times the vertical vorticity there. And so we just simply approximate that as a product of vertical the updraft speed and the vertical vorticity. At levels, we typically do look at levels between 2 and 5 kilometers above the ground and do some smoothing to get a nice field out of that. And that's what we get our updraft helicity. We started to generate updraft helicity between 0, basically the surface, to 3 kilometers to see if the low-level mesocyclone representation in the model has a little better correlation with tornado potential. Ryan Sobesh published a paper recently on that. Seems to suggest that the 0 to 3 UH, if you're looking at the low-level UH, likely getting more of the low-level mesocyclone, you typically, just compared to 2 to 5 kilometer UH, you get a better forecast. You're removing some of the elevated convection and elevated supercells that aren't going to produce a tornado. So